Come on in, guys. Welcome to Idled Out, where we talk all things Survivor. My name is Luke, and today we're talking about Survivor's biggest face turns. For those not up on their wrestling parlance, these are players who started the game playing or acting villainously, but somewhere along the way, through actions or circumstance, became bona fide heroes. It's a classic trope in all of media, and Survivor is no exception. The evil villain who realizes the error of their ways, and in the end, finds redemption. There are countless examples. Darth Vader, Jaime Lannister, Donkey Kong. And while there are plenty of examples of people from the literal villains tribe turning face, I'm going to keep this to single season arcs only. Otherwise, this top five would be just half the villains tribe, most of whom looked downright angelic when juxtaposed against Russell. If you're curious about the inverse of this, heroic players turned villain, well, I'd highly recommend you go check out my video on Survivor's greatest heel turns, where I cover all of our favorite players who began as angels but got corrupted by the dark side. All that said, let's dig in to Survivor's five biggest face turns. At number five is Jamal in Survivor: Island of the Idols. Jamal started Island of the Idols on the Vokai tribe, immediately forming a tight alliance with Molly and Jack. And with Nora and Jason on the outs at Vokai, he'd appear to be in a pretty comfortable position. A little too comfortable. Yes, Jamal, Molly, and Jack all fall prey to some classic early game overconfidence, not realizing that their supposedly secret alliance was incredibly obvious to everyone else on this tribe, so much so that Lauren dubs them the King, Queen, and Jack. You'll never guess which role Jack is playing. Jamal's overconfidence is not a great look. Even if I do basically agree with his analysis that the easy vote is the right choice to maintain tribe unity this early in the game. But, sorry Jamal, there's a wave of big move-itis going around your tribe. Now, I honestly wouldn't exactly call Jamal a villain at this stage in the game, but it's pretty clear that we're meant to root against him. Tommy paints Jamal and company as the cool kids table in the lunchroom, and Nora and Jason as the nerds. And an adolescence spent watching 80s teen movies taught me that cool kids always get their comeuppance from geeky underdogs. Luckily for Jamal, everyone else is far more terrified of Molly than of him, pretty unjustly fearing that she's Parvati 2.0 because she's, what, a pretty young woman? So he escapes this first vote intact. Things start looking up for Jamal shortly, though. He finds an immunity idol, and later gets a favorable swap to Lyro, honestly one of the most underrated post-swap tribes ever. I've said it before and I'll say it again, wish this crew gained control at the merge. Speaking of that, everything's looking up for Jamal until the merge hits, and the Dan situation boils over to the point that the vote is between Dan or Kelly. Jamal, along with Janet, Nora, and Karishma, side with Kelly, but it's not enough and Kelly is voted out. It's here that Jamal becomes one of the most sympathetic individuals in the game, as he comes to bat as one of Kelly's most vocal backers. The next day, Jamal finally gets a stroke of luck that can turn this season around in the form of an idol clue hanging from a tree. And, wait, hold on. This is actually a lose-a-vote disadvantage because there's, quote, no such thing as a free lunch on Survivor. We just had to dangle this in front of Jamal and Karishma. We couldn't slip one of these into the bags of Dan, Tommy, Lauren, Dean, Elaine, Aaron, and Missy. This just had to be found by Jamal. Okay. Jamal's unsurprisingly voted out here, capping off what is probably a bottom five, if not bottom one, episode of Survivor ever. But he goes out a genuine real-life hero who was just a little arrogant at the start of the game. If you want proof of what a great guy Jamal is, at Final Tribal, Dean asks Jamal to validate that his clearly fake handwritten legacy advantage is actually real. Jamal could have easily dunked on Dean here. I mean, I know I would. It would be hard not to. But he actually used the opportunity to argue in Dean's favor, saying that Dean forging a fake legacy advantage, and playing that instead was honestly quite clever. It's a testament to his kindness and empathy as a human being. Or maybe he just realized Dean dunks on himself enough. He doesn't need the help.
Yeah. We try to flush it right away?
Overnight. Yeah.
So then we just split the vote.
Everyone else is here.
Huh? Huh?
At number four is Jonathan Penner in Survivor Micronesia. Now, I know I said at the top, no multi-season arcs, and I stand by that. But I'm including Penner because he starts Micronesia as his standard, charmingly villainy self, only to get the most heroic exit this game's ever seen just a few episodes later. Things begin well enough for Penner in Micronesia. Cast on the Favorites tribe with an even bigger villain than him, and with two of his former Cook Islands castaways by his side. Granted, he betrayed both of these people multiple times in Cook Islands, but still, it's a pretty good draw. He then Avengers assembles an alliance that returnee season dreams are made of. Himself, Eliza, Amy, and Yao Man, with both Johnny Fairplay and Ciri as options for a fifth and sixth. Those margins are important because the other four players, Parvati, Amanda, James, and Ozzy, have paired off and formed their own couples alliance. The pause button on this showdown is pressed when Fairplay asks to be voted off first, leaving Ciri as a very crucial swing vote between two alliances of four. Episode 3 of Micronesia is Penner at his most villainous, as he realizes that Ciri is leaning quite heavily towards working with the couple's alliance to vote out Yao Man. And he becomes more and more desperate and frustrated as the episode goes on. It all culminates in a caveside conversation that quickly turns nasty, with Penner shrouded in a very fitting shadow, making one last, very argumentative plea to Ciri. Her face says it all. Yao Man is voted out, and the argument continues the next morning, with Jonathan again picking fights with Ciri over this alleged betrayal. Penner gets a potentially workable swap when he's sent to Irai, but a very, very poorly conceived challenge leaves him with a massive leg injury that goes south and quick. Following Penner's not great performance in the next reward challenge, Medical takes one look at him and decides it's time to pull him from the game, citing the potential for infection. Penner's love for the game as he's evacuated is palpable. Nearly everyone's moved to tears as he says his goodbyes. This is one of the reasons that Penner is one of my favorite Survivor players ever. Few people are as passionate about the game as he is, and that's on full display in his hero's exit. The show also directly contrasts this whole affair with Chet asking to be voted out later this episode over a piece of coral in his foot and completely screwing over all his allies in the process, making Penner look extra heroic by comparison. Granted, it's not terribly hard to look heroic next to Chet. Even the coral comes off looking pretty good this episode. Coral for second chances too. At number 3 is Holly in Survivor Nicaragua. Holly had a rough go in the early days of Nicaragua, starting with the very first tribal council, when she loses her only ally, Wendy Jo. Holly knows she's on the outside of the tribe and realizes she needs to get back into the good graces of, well, everyone. But what Holly thinks she should do and what she actually does are two very, very different things. She first snaps at Jill over some snails she's eating, taking the snails and dumping them out even though they're perfectly good to eat. Then when she overhears everyone talking about her, she takes Dan's $600 alligator shoes and dumps them in the water, destroying them completely. But at least she tied the laces before she did. She's so thoughtful. I have a lot of sympathy for Holly's day 4 meltdown. Even if she did steal and then destroy someone's property, losing your only ally and feeling completely on the outs is probably one of the biggest lows one can feel in the game. Logically, you know you have to work your way back into the tribe and build bridges. But anyone who has anxiety or other mental health disorders knows that sometimes doing what your head tells you you should do, and actually doing that, can be almost impossible. Still, the tribe is understandably upset with Holly's actions, even if she apologizes to Dan shortly thereafter.
Holly keeps getting stranger and stranger, and every time she speaks, it becomes more evident that she's crazy. So I'm gonna keep one eye on her and one eye on my shoes.
Sidebar, but I think it's hilarious that Dan looks incredibly imposing in some shots and then hilariously weak in others. He's like that buff dog meme. Anywho, Holly actually considers quitting the game on day 5, but gets a pep talk from Jimmy Johnson and stays in the game. And that's definitely for the best, as Holly goes on to be not only one of the best characters of Nicaragua, but one of its strongest players as well. In the driver's seat, both in her time on post-swap Espada and at the Merge, where she was a crucial part of the majority alliance and led the charge on big blindsides, like the one against Brenda. All along the way, Holly is an incredibly kind and positive presence, even trying her best to convince Purple Kelly not to quit the game. Which, well, you tried, Holly. She ends up going out in fourth as the last Espada member in the game and the biggest jury threat. A pretty impressive achievement and proof that you should never throw in the towel. Just Dan's shoes. The second greatest face turn in Survivor history is Rory in Survivor Vanuatu. Rory is a man who isn't afraid to speak his mind, which is great news for us because he's downright hilarious, giving classic one-liner after classic one-liner in confessionals with ease. And while his curmudgeonliness was fun to watch from the couch, on the island it rubbed some of his Lapevi tribe mates the wrong way. And then later his post-swap Yasser tribe mates the wrong way. And then later at the Merge, everyone the wrong way. In fact, Rory got votes at all six tribal councils he attended, an achievement both in his ability to irritate people so much they vote for him, and his ability to survive being the target tribal after tribal after tribal. At the start of the game, Rory irritates many of his Lapevi tribe mates almost immediately, giving orders and just generally being disagreeable. But he's insulated from any significant risk of going home by his alliance with the other older men, the Fat Five. Still, Rory's disposition begins to irritate even his allies. Like, I love how annoyed he is by Mia's victory dance in the Episode 2 Reward Challenge.
I don't think that we would have intentionally shoved somebody's nose into it. You know, that was nonsense. That was classless. Show some class. They're grown women. I understand it's a competition. But if she was a man, would you have taken that, Sarge? No.
When Rory is swapped to Yasser, his redemption arc begins. Sort of. First, he threatens to burn the camp down if he's voted out.
I am going to institute a slash, burn, and salt the earth policy. What that means is, if I get voted off this island, the Yasser tribe will burn. I can guarantee that.
But at the Episode 7 reward, which when Yasser wins some letters and photos from home, Rory's heart grows three sizes, as the photos from home help humanize him to the rest of the tribe, and his wife's letter advises him to not let his temper get the better of him. A serendipitous message if I've ever heard one. Rory then clutches the immunity challenge, nailing slingshot after slingshot and saving his own neck in the process. Unfortunately, once he gets to the Merge the next round, Rory's voted out by the Women's Alliance, the first victim of the gender war. But he goes down fighting and should honestly be proud that he made it out of the wood chipper known as post-swap Yasser alive. Putting a bow on his arc, we even get some rather touching final words.
I will never forget the Islands of Fire. No one has enjoyed the experience of being on this land more than I have.
Rory, I will remind you, you wanted to burn the entire island down not 3 days ago. The greatest face turn in Survivor history is Rob in Survivor Thailand. Where to begin with Rob? Pretty much the second he sets foot on the island, Rob is a total jerk. He eats all the bananas, he antagonizes Xi'an, he chokes Clay. Wait, sorry, I got my notes mixed up. I'm not supposed to get to the positive parts of his personality yet. Rob is a guy who says whatever he's thinking 100% of the time. He never really stops to consider the impact his words may have, or even if they make any sense at all.
The most upsetting thing about it is like the reward we had utensils and she was using her fingers.
Just disgusting. Like all of us have enough manners not to do that.
Appalling, dude. She's a girl too. Give me a break, dude.
I know.
Who the hell would take her on?
But then again, this is a guy who brought a skateboard as his luxury item to the beach. This is what we're dealing with. Rob's mouth has a tendency to get him in trouble. Everyone on Sukjai finds him rather irritating. One of my favorite parts of Survivor Thailand, which, granted, low bar, is watching Ken's face literally anytime Rob is saying anything at all. The only thing that moves faster than Rob's mouth is Rob's body. He's so high energy that when he's stung by a stingray and flops around in the ocean screeching, Penny, Jake, and Aaron don't even bat an eye. This is just a Tuesday afternoon for Rob. The episode 6 reward seems to change something in Rob, though. Over this simple reward, everyone on Sukjai begins to feel, for the first time, that they're a family. And no one is more touched than Rob, as he feels a closeness with his tribe mates and an appreciation for the little things in life. From here on out, it's epiphany after epiphany for Rob. It's genuinely moving. A conversation with Ken helps him understand himself and learn to accept help when it's offered to him. A visit to a cave gets him all nostalgic for the ephemeral nature of life. Later on, he realizes the important things in life aren't making money and getting wasted, it's family and getting wasted. Everyone on Sukjai is genuinely moved by Rob's turnaround. I mean, not moved enough to not vote him out the next day, but moved nonetheless. He's even extremely humble in defeat, something literally impossible to envision the Rob from, well, even the start of this episode being.
Rob, two B's. Two B's, guys.
His growth from abrasive jerk to slightly less abrasive, slightly less jerk is Survivor's greatest face turn ever. Got nothing else for ya. To help me get some $600 alligator shoes, like and subscribe, and I'll get you more Survivor content just like this. Until next time, don't get idled out.